Hey everyone, welcome to homeschool. In the previous video, we have completed the protists. So as in whole, we have completed two kingdoms, that is Monera and Protista. So today we will be starting with the kingdom fungi. So fungi, everyone has commonly seen them. If you keep bread for open for some 2-3 days, you will see some strands growing on it, or very tastiest fungi, that is mushrooms. So everyone has seen the one or other kind of fungi. But today we will see what are the characteristics, what are different classes which belong to the kingdom fungi, and what are its characteristics. Okay, so we will see first the general characteristics of the kingdom fungi, and then we will move to the characteristics of each and every class of it. So what are the characteristics of fungi? So they are mainly heterotrophic in nature. They are heterotrophic. It means they depend on other organisms or the autotrophs for their food. Fine. Next one. These are usually multicellular in nature. They are multicellular, but however there is one exception here for the multicellular, that is the yeast. Yeast is the exception. Yeast is the exception. Almost all the fungi are multicellular eukaryotic, but yeast is the exception because it is unicellular eukaryotic. Okay, it is unicellular eukaryotic. Third one. So how does the structure of the fungi or the body organization of the fungi looks like? These are filamentous in filamentous, that is, these are usually strand-like structures, or they have long thread-like structures called as hyphae. Long thread-like structures called as hyphae. So these hyphae, I will draw diagrams here. We will draw two types of hyphae here. Hyphae are of two types. One is septate, other one is aseptate. One is septate, other one is aseptate. So if you see a fungi or any other the organism which belongs to the fungi kingdom, if you get them under the microscope and if you observe it, you don't see it as some circular cell or some irregular shaped cell. You see it in a form of a sort of the filaments. You see it in filamentous form, that is, like there are many, a bunch of filaments, a bunch of threads are being aggregated, something like that it looks. So all those single filaments are called as the hyphae, and these hyphae can be of two types. The first one is septate. So imagine this is a long thread like structure, and there are some partitions in between. If you see the partitions in between, then these partitions are called as septas. So this hyphae is called as the septate hyphae. If there are no septas at all, if there are no partitions, then we call such hyphae as aseptate. So here what happens, inside these partitions we have nuclei present. So how exactly this looks like? So this is one partition or one single cell, and it is having one nuclei or uninucleate. Whereas in case of the second condition, there are no septas at all. So we are directly writing the nuclei here. So how does this look like? It looks like in one single cell only there are so many nuclei, isn't it? Though here also we have many nuclei, one single filament, but it doesn't look like that because there are septas. But here it looks like one filament has so many nuclei. So such a condition is called as cenocytic. It's called as cenocytic. So here the hyphae are of two types. The first one is the septate hyphae and the second one is the aseptate and cenocytic hyphae. Now the fourth one is the network of these hyphae. The network of hyphae is called as mycelium. It is called as mycelium. That is, as I said, when you observe a fungal sample under microscope, you won't be able to see very nice circular or oval shaped cells. You will be able to see some aggregations like this. So it will be like this. And these are all the single strands are called as hyphae, and the bunch of the hyphae or the network of the hyphae is called as the mycelium. And this mycelium or these hyphae can be septate or they can also be aseptate. Fine. And then the fungi can usually be saprophytic, they can be parasitic and they can be symbiotic. But however, these are heterotrophs only. The saprophytes, the parasites and the symbionts are all, they all come under the heterotrophs only. We shall write it here. These can be saprophytes, they can be parasites, they can be symbionts or they can be symbiotic organisms. Then next one is the presence of cell wall. The cell wall here is made up of a component called as chitin. Okay, the fungal cell wall is made up of chitin. Plant cell wall is made up of cellulose. Animals doesn't have cell wall at all. Bacterial cell wall is made up of peptidoglycan. Here the fungal cell wall is made up of the chitin. All right, next we will move on to the reproduction. So reproduction mainly takes place by vegetative reproduction, asexual reproduction and sexual reproduction also. So firstly we will see what is vegetative reproduction, how is it happening in case of fungi. Vegetative reproduction, so this is mainly by three process here. The first one is fission. Second one is budding and third one is fragmentation. Okay, first one is fission, second one is budding, third one is fragmentation. So what happens here in the fission? Again, we already have seen the fission. In very few fungi, the fission takes place. Generally, budding and fragmentation takes place in case of fungi. Some kind of yeast, all right, very few yeasts will undergo the fission process. That is, one single organism will break down to form two organisms, as we had seen it in the case of the bacteria. So similarly, here also it takes place. Budding, we have already seen the budding also. What happens? This also takes place in case of yeast, which we call it as Saccharomyces cerevisiae. So budding, what happens? A small outgrowth will come like this. This is a small outgrowth. Now this outgrowth will further grow like this, and after that it detaches from the mother cell and will form a new organism. That is called as budding. Fragmentation, so since it is filamentous, most of them are filamentous in nature, So one small fragment will detach from the main mycelium. So this is the mycelium. Let's imagine this small fragment has detached from the main mycelium. Now this will grow into another organism. So this is called as fragmentation. Fission, simple. One cell, we have genetic material inside. That genetic material will first duplicate, or it will multiply, and then all the whatever components are there inside, since it is a eukaryote, all the organelles will be present. Those organelles will all divide, and then the cell as a whole will divide into two new cells. Budding, in case of budding, what happens? A small outgrowth will come out like this from the main cell, and that will later grow and then detaches from the mother cell. Fragmentation, a small fragment of the hyphae or the mycelium will come out, and that fragment will grow into a new structure. That is called as the fragmentation. This is about the vegetative reproduction in case of fungi. In detail, everything we will see when we study the various classes under the kingdom fungi. Fine. Then asexual reproduction. Asexual reproduction is mainly by the formation of spores, even in case of sexual reproduction also. So asexual reproduction, we will write it here. Asexual reproduction, this is by formation of mainly three types of spores. This is by formation of spores. What are the types of spores formed here? So first one is the conidia, second one is the zoospores, third one is the sporangiospores. First one is conidia, then sporangiospores, and then zoospores. So these are the three types of spores which are formed in case of the asexual reproduction. How about the sexual reproduction? Here also we get to see various types of spores here. So what are the types of spores which we see here? Is the first one is oospores. Right, the first type of spores which we see here is the oospores, and then ascospores. Second one is the ascospores, then it is basidiospores. So in case of asexual reproduction, we usually see conidia, sporangiospores, and the zoospores. In case of sexual reproduction, we see oospores, ascospores, and the basidiospores formation. So along with these types of spore formation in the sexual reproduction, there are certain processes also happening here. So we will just see what are those processes here. In detail, we'll study it while doing with the classes of the fungi. So the first process is the fusion of protoplasm. Fusion of the protoplasm, which is called as plasmogamy. It is called as fusion of protoplasm is called as plasmogamy. The second one is the fusion of nuclei, which is called as karyogamy. Fusion of nuclei, which is called as karyogamy. So what happens in these two cases, plasmogamy and karyogamy? I will just draw the diagrams here. So let's imagine we have a cell like this. So protoplasm and we have nucleus. Since these are eukaryotic in nature, they should definitely have a well-defined nucleus. I will slightly write it here. I'll wipe it. Okay. So we have two cells like this. And these are the nuclei part. Fine. These two cells, before the fusion of the nuclei, the cells will fuse like this. It means their cytoplasmic contents will fuse. So the fusion of the cytoplasmic contents or the protoplasm part of the cell is called as the plasmogamy, the fusion of the protoplasm. Fine. Then later on, when the nuclei will fuse, we call it as a karyogamy. So after the plasmogamy, the karyogamy will take place. After the karyogamy, one more process will take place here, that is the meiosis. Later on, after the plasmogamy and karyogamy, the meiosis will take place to form the haploid spores. It forms haploid spores. So if you are quite confused, no issues, you just remember the definitions here. Any one of the class, we will go in detail how exactly sexual reproduction happens, what is plasmogamy, what is karyogamy, what is dikaryon stage and everything. In detail, we will take one example in any of the classes and we will go for it. Fine. So as in now, so remember these general characteristics of the fungi. And after this, we are gonna study four important classes here. The first one is the phycomycetes, second one is ascomycetes, third one is basidiomycetes, and the fourth one is the deuteromycetes. Okay, so I hope you have understood this. We will move on with the phycomycetes now. Phycomycetes, these are the fungi which are mainly aquatic in nature. So these are majorly aquatic in nature. And these are saprophytic and parasitic. These are saprophytic and parasitic. So that is, they can, few of the fungi which belong to phycomycetes, they usually depend on the living host and few depend on the dead and decaying matter. Then body organization, or how exactly the mycelium looks like. These are aseptate. What is aseptate? We have already seen it previously. That is, aseptate is without the septa. If there are no septa, then what do we call that condition as? So it's only we have nuclei here. If there are no septa, then definitely it should be cenocytic in nature. It is cenocytic in nature. Then how exactly they reproduce? So the reproduction, firstly we'll speak about the asexual reproduction. So asexual reproduction here is by the zoospores. Asexual reproduction is by zoospores. Remember, zoospores are the motile spores here. These are the motile spores. Another type of spores which also participate in the asexual reproduction is the aplanospores, and these aplanospores are non-motile in nature. Another one is aplanospores. Aplanospores, that is non-motile spores. Okay, so The asexual reproduction here, majorly two types of spores are involved. The first one is the zoospore, which is a motile spore, and the second one is the aplanospore, which is a non-motile spores here. Then spores here, they are formed in a structure called as the sporangia. So the spores are formed in a structure called as sporangia. So sporangia is a small ball like structure. Inside the sporangia are a bulb like structure, and inside that the spores are being formed. Hence we can call these spore formation as endogenous spore formation. We can call it as endogenous spore formation. Then another type of spore formation here is the formation of zygospores. So this is mainly formed by the fusion of gametes, or I'll write it as by fusion of gametes. Okay, now if fusion of gametes means there should be two gametes, and those two will fuse to form a single zygospore. If the gametes which are fusing here, if those are similar gametes, okay, if the gametes which are getting fused are similar gametes, then we call it as isogamous, or we call it as isogamy. And if the gametes which are involved here, if they are dissimilar, if they are not same, then we call it as anisogamous. Dissimilar gametes. Then we call them as anisogamous. Okay. So in case of zygospores, it is produced by the fusion of the gametes. And if the gametes which are getting fused are similar in their characteristic, if they are same, then we call it as isogamous or isogamy. And if it is dissimilar, then we call it as anisogamous or anisogamy. And few examples to quote here in case of phycomycetes is, the first example we will take of mucor. The first one is mucor. Second one is rhizopus, which is very commonly called as the bread mold. Bread mold. And then the third one is the albugo, which is a parasite. So albugo is a parasite for the mustard plant. Mucor, rhizopus and albugo. So the phycomycetes are aquatic in nature. They are saprophytic and parasitic. Parasitic means dependent on the living host. Saprophytic means dependent on the dead and decaying organic matter. Then they are aseptate and cenocytic, that is, the hyphae doesn't have any septa here. There are no partitions, and it seems to be like one filament with many number of nuclei, hence we call it as cenocytic condition. Then asexual reproduction, that is mainly by the formation of the zoospores and the aplanospores. Zoospores are motile spores, aplanospores are non-motile spores. Then spores are formed in a structure called as sporangia. Sporangia is a very enclosed structure, bulb-like structure. Inside the sporangia, the spores are being formed. Hence, we call it as endogenous spore formation. Then, next type of the reproduction or the spore formed is the zygospores, and this is by the fusion of the gametes. And the gametes which are getting fused here is, if they are similar gametes, then we call it as isogamous, and if they are dissimilar gametes, we call them as anisogamous. And few examples to quote for the phycomycetes is mucor, rhizopus and albugo. Clear? So next we will move on to the another class, that is ascomycetes. Ascomycetes are also called as sac fungi. They are also called as sac fungi. So we will quickly see what are the characteristics of the ascomycetes. These are unicellular and they can also be multicellular. Okay, see, all the organisms under the ascomycetes are multicellular. Only one organism, that is the yeast, yeast belongs to the ascomycetes. We had seen it in the general characterization of the kingdom fungi, that all the fungi are multicellular eukaryotes except one organism, that is the yeast, which is unicellular eukaryote. So that unicellular eukaryote yeast is placed under the class of ascomycetes. So all the other classes have only multicellular organisms. Only ascomycetes in the fungi, in the kingdom fungi, have unicellular organism also. So that is, the unicellular is the yeast, and multicellular, there are many organisms of the multicellular belongs to the ascomycete. One example we will take, penicillium. Okay, so penicillium is a very famous organism which gives the antibiotic penicillin. Penicillium notatum is the organism which gives the antibiotic, or which produces the antibiotic penicillin. Okay, next, these organisms, the organisms which come under the ascomycetes, they can be saprophytic. They can be decomposers. They can be parasitic. And they can also be coprophilus. Now, what are these coprophilus? Coprophilus are the organisms which usually grow on the excreta of other organisms or dung of the other organisms. Alright, waste of the other organism, like cow dung or something. So, any excreta. So, those organisms which grow on the excreta are called as the coprophilus. Fine. They can be saprophytic, they can be decomposers, they can be parasitic, and they can be coprophilus. Then, how about the body structure, or how is the mycelium of the ascomycetes? It is usually branched and septate one. The mycelium. Mycelium is branched and septate. It is branched and septate. Then moving on to the reproduction part. So the asexual reproduction, firstly, asexual reproduction. So this is by the formation of the conidia here. Asexual reproduction is by the formation of conidia, which are produced exogenously on conidia produced exogenously on conidiophores. So we will see what exactly the conidiophore is or what exogenously it means. So in the previous phycomycetes, we had seen that spores are being formed endogenously in the sporangium. So sporangium is a small bulb like structure. Inside it the spores were formed, so we call it as endo. Endo is inside something, so it was endogenously formed. Whereas now here the spores are exogenously formed, that is the spores are like produced outside, they are being exposed here. So we will just see the diagram how exactly it looks like. So this is a mycelium. A mycelium, and here the mycelium is branched and septate. So we shall show few septa here, and it has nuclei inside. Okay, and it says that it is branched. So we will draw one branch like this. Okay, we will draw one branch here. So it should have two or three segments like this. One second. Yeah. See, what it says is the spores are exogenously formed. It means they should be outside here. They should not be inside somewhere. They should be exposed or they should be outside. So, this is the structure. This is the branching here. Now on these we can see the spores like this. So spores are attached to this. Fine. So it is a branched structure, and this is called as conidiophores. This is conidiophore. This is conidiophore, and this is a septate mycelia or septate hyphal strand. Together we can call it as mycelia, and single, since we had written it, we can take it as a septate hyphal strand. Fine. Now these are the spores. I'll write it as conidia. These are the conidia. These spores, okay, let's imagine we have one single spore, and this spore has detached from the this spore has separated from the branch. Now this spore will again germinate into a new mycelium. Okay, I'll repeat again, this is a branched mycelium, and at the end, at the tip of the conidiophore extension, we have the spores which are exogenously formed. So they are formed outside, they are exposed. These spores usually get detached at times. When they detach, every single spore will form a new hyphae or new mycelium. Alright, this is the asexual reproduction taking place. How about the sexual reproduction? sexual reproduction mainly takes place by the ascospores. They take place by ascospore formation. And remember again, ascospores are also endogenously formed in the sac, which is called as asci. Ascospores are endogenously formed in, they are endogenously formed in a small sac, in sac called as asci, which are called as asci. And these asci are arranged, these asci are arranged in the fruiting bodies, which are called as ascocarp, okay. See, in the starting I had said that ascomycetes are called as sac fungi. That is because they usually form the sac-like structures, which are called as the asci, which will bear the sexual spores for the sexual reproduction. Hence, they are called as sac fungi. So, the sexual reproduction is by the formation of the ascospores, which are being produced endogenously in a sac called as asci, and which are arranged, these asci are arranged in the fruiting bodies called as the ascocarp. Clear? So I hope you have understood the phycomycetes as well as the ascomycetes.